Hi.
I will try to switch on my video, guys. I would request everyone if you can turn on the video. It would be really nice to see each other and say hi to Ria also.
Yeah, that will be nice. I don't want to talk to all. Hey, hi everyone.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good
You
morning.
guys had your morning tea?
Hi.
Yes. So it's 9:30 over here, around quarter to 10 today, and yes, I think it's quite late at your end also. Like it should be
It's
nine.
9:30. Yeah,
Okay.
that's fine.
Great,
I'm
great.
very sorry. I somehow messed up with the IST
Wonderful. Thank you for joining in, Ria. Really nice to have you on this platform today. And so we have 20 members in the group.
Okay.
Yeah, so we have 20 of them, and people are joining in. I'm just allowing the attendees in the group at the same time. So
Sure.
I was thinking if you could start with a nice introduction of yourself, and we could introduce each other a little bit, and then we can continue with the session. And yeah.
Definitely. So first of all, good morning, guys. Thank you so much. Saturday morning, and you guys are on time joining this session. So hope everyone is doing okay with the current mess is going around right now. I'm Riya Tosar, and actually I know Romy for quite some time. We have worked together. I come with over 2 decades of experience in design, I would say, particularly in user experience. Before that, I would say my initial years of my career, I actually spent exploring a lot of things. So started with graphic design, then I explored traditional animation. So I worked with some animation studios. Then I got into UI design, the time where it was CBT, WBT era, right? And dot-com boom. So that's where I got exposed to the concept of UI design, and I felt something clicked that time, which was very interesting. The way you think about creating UI, the way you think about the users, it was very different perspective. So that's where I decided this is something I'm going to explore further. And here I am, like around almost 24, 25 years now in user experience. Last, I would say, initial years after I got into user experience, I was into consulting. And then after that, last 7 years, I'm into product design. So interesting journey, I would say. I could see a lot of variety of domains I worked for, different mediums I could work for, and lot of learning. So yeah, it's pretty interesting journey, and definitely I would love to share maybe my learnings with you guys today. So yeah, over to you. I would
Wonderful.
love to hear what background you guys are from. Anyone like you want to volunteer to talk?
Yes, absolutely wonderful, Ria. Thanks for sharing it with us. And so, meanwhile, Ria, I will just switch off my video at times because the internet connection is not that great these days
Sure,
because of all
sure.
the lockdown things. And yeah, so guys, would you like to introduce yourself to Ria? So Ria, for us from my side, I have Biswajit and Kailash who will be co-hosting with from IGF Kolkata's point of view. Hi Biswajit, Kailash. Hi.
Hi, hi,
Hi.
Dia.
Hi
Hi,
Biswajit.
Ria.
How are you? Hi.
I'm Kailash. I am from Ranchi, and I have started UX since last 2 years, and
Okay.
I am associated with a company called 365 here at Ranchi, and we serve global clients in both Dubai and Aberdeen,
Okay.
Scotland.
Okay.
And I am into UX with associated with them.
Okay. So
And
most of the group here, everyone is from UX background, or people are from different background?
there are people from different background as well.
Yes.
I
Yeah.
think one
I think a quick
was
round
from
robin would help us understand the different backgrounds that we are from. So guys, would you like to just pitch in for a minute or a few seconds, maybe? Yeah, just to understand each other's background.
Yeah, maybe what we can do, just say 5 minutes, you guys can talk about maybe different people, because I have also seen there are people who are from, say, front-end background, but they are interested into getting into UX, right? Or they turned into UX designers. So those are interesting combinations. So yeah, just it would be nice to at least briefly, I know there are a lot of people, so we can't go through everyone, but at least whoever wants to, if you have a different background, just introduce. And then what I can do is maybe a couple of projects I can show from some of my case studies from the different background or the different mediums which I worked for. So that can give you a good idea in terms of how different areas you can wave together, right? In terms of when it comes as a designer, you can actually leverage all your different experiences and design a product.
Absolutely. I think that sounds perfect, Priya. Yeah.
Hello. So my name is Sadaiva. So I studied product design in UG. 4 to 5 years. Then I did my internship at TCS, and now I am studying further in design strategy and UX. So I am here. Yeah.
So where are you right now? You are still studying, or?
I'm still finishing my PG. Right now I'm in Mumbai.
Okay, that's a good combination. It's nice.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me do one thing. Let me get into, I can show you something quickly from my work. Let me share my screen, okay? So let me know once you see.
Yes, we can see it, yeah.
So guys, as I said, like so many years of experience, but it was fun because the kind of roles I have played, right from the beginning. So as I started right from college, I was obviously a junior designer. So my roles were like that. But as I started growing as a designer, there are different type of roles which I played, and that's how I guess that design maturity that comes in a picture. So maybe I would talk about first when I started as a designer. There are a few case studies which I want to definitely talk about. These are some of the quick snippets of the work that so far I have done, and this is something I have done with when I was with Cognizant. At Cognizant, I was actually managing a large team of designers across different locations, and it was extraordinary work all of us we have done as a team. Again, it was not just a visual designer or interaction designer, but the way we worked together, it was like we had technical writers, creative writers, we have illustrators, animators. So it was a variety of skills that we worked together. This is something you can see. It was a digital strategy project for one of the American product where we had website design, and we had also some event related microsite design as well as mobile device design. So when you design, I had the opportunity to work for different kind of form factors also, right? Because when you design for iPad, mobile, website, even the physical products like ATM machine, you definitely learn a lot of things while working for that medium. This was some of one of the work, website work we did for Club Mahindra. And that was, I think, another unique concept that we had. So a lot of you, this concept you will see, we had a creative background people who were working with ad agencies earlier, and then they joined Cognizant. So collaborating with such skills is always help when you're working in a team. Let me show you one of the case studies. This was interesting project actually. So this was for Motorola, actually India. And this was, I would say, more of a ideation project that they came to us. And this was when I was with Human Factors International. The project was all about creating basically localized or Indianized version of all the wallpapers for Motorola for their new product which they were planning to launch. So these were all wallpapers and screensavers. So you would see this was more of a creative design project. It was more about the visual aspect. It was more about how can you leverage some of the rituals that we have in India and turn that into these concepts.
That is really interesting, yeah.
It was really interesting actually, and this was, I think, a quite rapid project. I don't exactly remember the timeline, but this was pretty fast-paced project. And I remember we had a team of visual designer entirely working on this project. It was fun.
Yes, yeah. Because even I remember when I was in Cognizant Ria, so few of the works I could relate to. I remember the works from that time.
Yeah, and you know how we work, right, as a team. Together, we had so many variety of skills, and it was all about how can we leverage each other's skills and how can we build something which is really amazing. So it was all about
absolutely.
This is very interesting and one of my favorite project because the kind of methodologies we have gone through, and I could actually also do eye tracking and user testing during this project. So my role was more of a design lead on this project. I was working with one of my visual designers and interaction designers back in Mumbai that time. So this is a company called AAA, which is again an insurance company in US, based in mid-Atlanta, in the center of United States. So project was all about how can you redefine the overall strategy for AAA, because AAA actually as a product had multiple offerings. But you, most of their customers used to know them only as a roadside assistance brand. So that's where AAA wanted to actually rebrand everything and also rework on the overall digital strategy. And that's where they reached out to us when I was working with Human Factors that time. So the reason I'm explaining you like this because you can relate how actually designer can play multiple responsibilities, or how even for this particular project I was in US that time for a couple of months, though this was a consulting project. I stayed here in Boston for a couple of months, work with customer, the initial requirement gatherings, understanding what exactly the current problem is, understanding the competition. And while doing all these things, I was very closely working with all the executive leadership of AAA. And at the same time, I had a team in India, back in India. So I was collaborating with them on a daily basis in terms of whatever the outcome of that day, I used to collaborate with them. So the activities I would say that we did is basically the first, it was all about understanding what is the problem. So heuristic analysis of the current website, what they had. So you can see first is defining the problem, then identifying, again, this is the immediate, I'm showing the end state, but there are a lot of things which has gone through between this stage. So you can see what things actually I have performed during that particular project. So first is consumer validation we did for the new design. Then we did eye tracking. So PET scan is something which was another methodology which we have used, which is basically persuasion, emotion, and trust. So basis on that, you basically test user and ask certain question, and on that basis you identify some of the improvement areas. We define personas, and then again in terms of, as I said, like AAA is known for multiple services, but it wasn't known. So information architecture and basically having the opportunity architecture mapping is something that we did, identifying the gaps, actually where is the broken link right now, how we can connect all these services, how we can market it. So all of that. And what you see in the right side is the redesigned interface. So this was the one which got implemented. You can see some of the samples of how we did eye tracking. So you can see the heat map. This is in the below. You can see we were testing users. This is again a persona development. As I talked about card sorts, this is something I did along with our executive director who I was working with. So we did this at the customer's place, so along with their stakeholders. This is basically the PET sort map, where you can see how we are trying to connect the dots, right? There are these, the red dots are basically different services. And what are the things, what are the other services they have within that services? And then how can we cross-sell, or how can we connect those all services together? So this was one of the activity that we did. Again, as I said, like it's not only about design, but it is also about how can you use the language which is more persuasive, or which user can relate to. So I would say this was also one of the big exercise that we did, is rewriting the content of the website. And of course, we had technical writers with whom I worked with. And it was all about, so here you can see the example, like left side, it was before how they were explaining the benefits of AAA membership, but it wasn't very clear. There were a lot of questions, because as you say, at the moment you talk about membership, there are a lot of questions, what all is covered, how much money, all of that, right? So customer, actually your customer should get those answers upfront. So rewriting the content was another big exercise that we did. And I would say overall, the design, redesign was pretty successful in terms of, as we tested afterwards, it was a big hit. Like it was almost 99% success. So this is one case study. Anyone has any question about it?
Yeah, so I think Anith has a question about, he wanted to understand what is the process of doing the card sorting. So Anith, would you like to elaborate on that, please?
Yeah, thank you, Romy. So I want to know how this, I'm also pretty new to UX. I'm a business analyst by role. So, and I have an interest towards UX also. I'm started learning the UX piece. So I have heard this card sorting multiple times, but I am not very clear how that is done. So that's why.
So, see, card sorting, there are right now, since everything is virtual, I'm also right now using actually Mural for card sorting. I don't know how many of you started using Mural or any other.
I have started using it, and it's really a wonderful platform to collaborate.
A wonderful platform.
Yes. Use their existing templates also. They have nice templates for using. And it really helps in collaborating mostly. Like,
Yes. So, see, there are different techniques how you do it, open card sort or closed card sort, right? But particularly for this project, the way I have done it, it was done on site. So we had all the primary stakeholders from different businesses. And then it was all about the session was full day session. Mm-hmm. And the task was they have to write down on the post-its everything, whatever they have in their businesses. So all the services, right, and their service owners, they had to write about on each post-it what all they have in their services. And then later on, basically through design thinking session, we actually grouped all that information together, and that's how actually information architecture we finalized. Mm-hmm. So while the way it starts is basically you put down everything you have, what you know you have in your business, in the post-it, like you write it down and put it there. And then as you start slowly, you see the patterns, like say, for example, now it is all about roadside assistance. So anything related to that bigger theme goes under that particular bucket. So that's how we started grouping the themes or grouping the services. So that's the typical way how you would do it. Depends on the project requirement, what's the goal, the technique, the timing, everything in terms of the length of activity, all these things changes. But yeah, that's the basic way we do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
So I have a question regarding card sorting.
Yeah.
So I have always find difficulty while transitioning from card sorting information architecture. So is there something to bridge the gap between it?
So why do you face that issue? I would like to first understand why that transition is difficult for you. What is that you don't get it?
Like there are two different kinds of card sorting, like as you discussed right now. Mm-hmm. So when we are doing information architecture, we always decide ki what should come first. And then when we are doing UX or UI process, we are also doing screens. So I have a bit of confusion there because there is a different hierarchy in both.
So see, first of all, information architecture is something, it's about how you want to use that website or that application, right? So that time you are not really thinking about screens.
Okay.
What you are thinking about is, what are the areas, right? Or what are the sections of your website that you really want to highlight for your user? How you want to sell your product?
Okay.
Right? So information architecture is also aligned with the way you want to sell your product, because you want the way you want your site menu, so that's how you want to sell it. That's how you want to say, maybe it's a product website. You want to have your products upfront. So if you say, see Apple website, right? It's all about their menu, is all about product first.
Okay.
Right? So it is also depends on, that's why I said, like, depends on what company or organization you're working for, doing this exercise for, what product you're doing this exercise for. In this particular case, it was all about like services. How can we make sure that AAA customers know all the services they have?
Okay.
So that was the objective, and that's how then we came up with the themes. The information architecture was all around how can we show those services upfront, so their customers know that it's their AAA is not just about road assistance, but it is about multiple other things.
Okay. So the services which are more important should come first in the information architecture, which we need to advertise or prioritize.
In this particular case, that was the need.
Okay.
So see, your web product architecture should also needs to be aligned with what's your product vision, right?
Okay.
What's your business vision? What you want to achieve as a business?
Okay.
So a lot of these things, everything should be aligned.
Hmm.
Because maybe as a organization, you have some different goal, but then your website reflects something else. It's not directing your audience towards that goal. Then it's definitely going to fail, right?
Yeah.
So that's why, what is the goal? What is it that you're trying to achieve in that that exercise? That should be clear. And then accordingly, as a facilitator, you have to, suppose you are facilitating that session, design thinking session, you have to guide people. So that's where the script is also very important in these workshops, because the kind of questions you ask is going to drive that entire discussion and the overall steps that everyone is going to take.
Okay.
So that's very critical and that's very key. So also what kind of question you ask, that is important. So I think that will help you when you have the alignment of what is the goal, what are you trying to achieve through that product or whatever you are designing. And then accordingly, you are clear, okay, this is my business goal, this is my user goal. And then accordingly, you drive the discussion.
Yeah. Okay.
Try doing that. Don't go to screen level, because screen level starts later part when you have or the architecture and you have the initial concept in terms of what is it that you want to achieve. It's more detailed design stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tell me. Anyone has any other question? How do I bring back this?
Yeah, I think Deepthiman asked something like how to document the design system for responsive UI. Is it required to document all the changes in different breakpoints? Here, changes means the element property like font size as logic, etc. Deepthiman, would you like to elaborate on the same?
Yeah, I can talk about that. So actually, this is very relevant to what I'm doing right now, because at SAP, actually, we have a design system called Fiori.
Okay.
So majority part of our UI, we use those components. So we use our Fiori design system. We make sure that the UI components, the fonts, colors, all those guidelines are followed. But when you're working with development, right, that time what you have to do is, even though Fiori has a guidelines, but not necessarily all the use cases are covered, right?
Yes, that's where my question is, Ria. When we create a website, what I'm giving an example to understand it better, my perspective. When we create a website, we have a menu, and that same menu converted into a hamburger menu in mobile. So if we write a document against that, then for website it will be a navigation and the design system will reflect that navigation, but for mobile it will reflect against hamburger menu. So that documentation also required. And in case of for example iPad, menu font size may be little bit reduced. So these things based on device we need to document, but I have not found any design system in market that documenting these things. So that's why my query is there.
So see, most of these things are actually when you have a design system, you also have a code, right? It is also for development, not just designers, right? So most of these UI components, for example, if it is responsive, are made like that. So what may be, at least what I am doing at SAP, is when we are doing a responsive design, I give the breakpoints, right?
Yes.
Where exactly actually your design breaks for mobile or iPad and how it is in the desktop. So I give the breakpoints. I just explain the behavior of important, as you said, navigation, how it is going to work. And I show the design. So mobile will be like this, iPad will be like this. So I have an example for each form.
Yes, and Ria, sorry to interrupt you. I also do same thing, that for each breakpoint, we create a separate kind of example design and give it to developer. But my question is, should we also do documentation against that?
So how are you giving UX specifications? How do you
basic document? Questions, right now we are using XD and via cloud we are sharing it.
Mm-hmm.
So specification is going via cloud and they can, otherwise Zeppelin is also there, via Zeppelin we can share. But apart from that, I am only asking about specifically documentation, means a design system where we can write these points.
So I actually have a design system, but I can't show that for SAP, which I have built actually 2 years okay. back. So for my product is called Cloud for Customer. So we have built our own product design system because it's a big product and there are a lot of things which is not just Fiori, but we had to develop apart from Fiori because Fiori was not supporting some of the use cases. But then what we did is we definitely documented, as you said, what we did. We broke down into different UI components. For example, there is a floor plan, right?
Okay.
So I don't know what you call it, but it's basically different layouts, right? Yes. For example, you have a search page, you have a home page. So these are different floor plans. So we documented all the floor plans, their behavior, their layout. So each of these primary elements, right? As a designer or as a developer, what all they need, it was all documented. And it was created on Wiki.
Okay.
So everyone within a product or within SAP, they had access to it. So floor plans, icons, basically visual design specifications, then interactions, right? In terms of what are the interaction patterns. So how certain component works or how certain floor plan works, right? So, and in what cases, in what use cases you should be using them. So this was all documented on Wiki. Okay. And it was a huge project, I would say. Almost a year we were documenting all of that. So it was a continuous effort as we were building the product, building the new features. So as we used to build it in the product, we used to update it in the design system. So okay. Yeah, that's how we did it.
Yeah, that's what's my, I have another question to you.
Mm-hmm.
Like for accessibility, there are a lot of guidelines, but few guidelines were really difficult to meet actually. So in that case, what should we do? For example, I can share one point like, for mobile accessibility, they said that font size should be 200% increasable from what we design. So if we gave that option 200% of my current font size, that will be a disaster for my design.
Yeah. So these are very tricky things. I know because we also had the similar kind of a issue when we were designing for responsive, right?
Yes.
So what we used to do, actually, this is something a visual designer in our team, they used to define all these things. And the font size, I think we were using REM as a unit. So not just
yes.
So REM we were using, and again the percentage, it was a lot of testing. That's how finally we could crack it in terms of what exactly the font size. So I don't know what you guys must be calling it, but we had a cozy compact kind of a mode.
Sorry, can you repeat?
So we had a cozy compact kind of a mode. When you can switch the font size to smaller one or a little bigger one. So
yes,
we had that adjustment.
Yes, that's what we are also doing in our designs, like 2 point less and 2 point up. So
yeah.
That's what we're doing. But in case they are saying 200%, means if we are using 16px, which is one is default for every browser, then our font size goes to 32px. In that case, it will be difficult to maintain design. That's what I am facing personally.
So in what scenarios they are asking you to do this?
200? To compliance with accessibility guidelines.
Accessibility. Okay. So see, right now, at least with our product, we just started getting into accessibility.
Yes.
That's another thing which I have seen here in Bay Area. Not all products are accessible.
Right.
Which I somehow felt in India, that awareness was there right from the beginning. So, but now, yes, like many of the products are getting into that accessibility compliance mode. So, right now, maybe, I don't know, I don't have that exact answer because so far I have not faced that issue.
Yes.
But I'm sure I will be facing that issue soon because as we start getting into accessibility mode, right, a lot of things will change now. So far, I have not faced this.
From IDF courses, Frank Spiler, that accessibility, the person who is teaching us for accessibility, he is also saying that accessibility, what W3C says or any guideline says, this is not the 100% thing that we can achieve, but we need to think about how people can use it actually.
There are some things which you can't, of course, financial organizations are 100% compliant. They have no choice.
Yes.
But rest, I think the rules are little not that strict.
Unfortunately, and unfortunately, I am working for a financial organization. That's why it's required.
I can feel the pain because this is something, I guess, long in Cognizant only. We worked for Wells Fargo, we did. Then we worked for Bank of New York Mellon. So all of them, they were 100% accessibility compliant.
Yes.
But that's all. The point is, see, some of the product depends on your audience, who's the target audience. Accessibility compliance is not that strict. So I think still product are able to manage and get away with maybe few yes. things. But eventually, I think it will start. At least accessibility in terms of hearing, right, or the visual color aspect,
right?
So some of these things are I'm seeing that immediately get addressed, but not the other font and these kind of things.
Yes. Thanks, Ria.
Yeah. Thank you. Anyone has any question? So yeah, so apart from that, I can show you something else.
Yeah, hi Ria, this is Robert.
Yeah, Robert.
Yeah, so sorry, I joined a bit late. I'm not sure if you answered this question. So on design system, like when do you generally start doing the design system? Like in the beginning of the design or like towards the middle or towards the end?
So see, design system either now again it depends on your organization, right? Sometime in startup, suppose it's a new product, you start building it along with as you start building concepts, right? But organizations like which are established organizations, they already have maybe design systems.
Yeah, right.
There you start following those systems and then start building the blocks, whatever is missing, right? Or some of them like Google. Google has completely like everything within Google, they can just follow as is.
Right.
So it's always up to date. But then it differs as base to base what organization you're working for.
Yeah. So like maybe you're starting a product from scratch. So like...
I am just trying to see if I can find the example actually.
Okay.
For my design system, which I have built actually at SAP. So let me just quickly check.
So nowadays I saw that many companies they introduce that design sprint. Previously it was not there. Like they want to engage all the main stakeholder of that, like from development side or the testing side, to understand the design from the sketch at the immediate point before the sprint start, they start a design sprint because this is for all the culture, this design sprint is available or only for that some company follow this thing?
No, so this is available for everyone.
Okay, so before...
Within product organization, everyone should be able to follow it or use it.
Okay.
That's the idea. I'm trying to find actually, sorry, there are so many things. Okay, anyway, let me see if I can find it. I can show you before we close our call today. But that was about design system. But yes, design system actually, especially with product organization, is used very heavily. Now, actually, we also started using abstract. I don't know how many of you use abstract, but that's also one part of using the design system, right? The library or the UI components across your product. So there is no inconsistency. So yeah, these new players are coming in the market, abstract and mural and everything. So with all the virtualization, I think the way we work is also changing.
Absolutely.
Yep. What else? What are the questions you have, guys?
Yeah, so I think we had one more question from Ratul. Ratul, would you like to share your question you asked the other day?
Yeah, right. So, Ria, I am a principal consultant. I worked with Harman earlier, and right now I'm doing my own freelancing work and all. So, I work with a lot of companies, and I work with product companies, service companies, and culture play an important role in all these organizations. So when I saw your past experience working with Cognizant, then LinkedIn and SAP Lab, SAP Labs and LinkedIn both are product-based companies. So how is this corporate culture? How do you see these things different? Or tell us something, some of the stories.
It's very different, I would say, because see, LinkedIn again, it's a young brand, right? And SAP is more like a very matured, very established legacy brand. So obviously, there is definitely cultural change. But I would put it like both has a different personality. I would put it that way. Because so LinkedIn, particularly LinkedIn, is average age group, I would say, is 35 to 40. Okay, and the average age must be around 45 to 50. So, which makes a lot of difference, right? In terms of the culture is the way maybe the decisions are taken. It's well thought through. It's a long-term approach always. It's not about what you want to achieve immediately, but it is more about think through 10 years ahead, right? Like that. Versus LinkedIn is something... I would say very energetic in terms of coming up with very new ideas and risk taking in terms of product. If you want to develop some product, there is always that attitude of taking risk. So, and again, it's not only the part of because of the certain issue, but it is also the way company vision is. And that's how company works, right? Operates. So LinkedIn, the way their vision is, say that their vision is basically connecting everyone in the world, right? To help them find the jobs. So it's very aggressive goal, I would say. Imagine well, so many.
I would like to pick some of the things. Pardon me, I don't want to hurt anybody, but these things came in the media, so I want to pick it up. few years back, what happened is the LinkedIn CEO visited some kind of conference, and somebody directly told him in front of his face, the design is very poor in LinkedIn. You know, it really happened. And it has been videotaped also. And then he tried to, you know, put some kind of, you know, maram lagana. So he tried to wrap it up somehow. And then he came back, and then he started improving the LinkedIn design. But then again, if you look at LinkedIn and if you compare it with Facebook, because all of these are social network, right? And then Google Plus was there. So although Google Plus completely boomed, and then there is Twitter. And in last few months, Elon Musk came and gave some idea to improve Twitter UI to the CEO of Twitter. And he also thanked about it. So from that perspective, how do we LinkedIn design in the back end, you know, from the cultural perspective, from the way...
So what do you think about design now? What do you think of LinkedIn design now?
It's very heavy. It's not as you know fluid.
No, I'm saying compared to maybe I don't know how many years back that comment was, but compared to that, what do you think now?
I think that the you know I'll tell you from another perspective. Whenever I picture the stakeholders, I feel like they have a big mustache and very heavy chin. A rock, and that's how the stakeholders are in LinkedIn. Because I've given a lot of suggestion over Twitter, and they have not been taken promptly, to be very frank. But on the other side, when I give suggestions to Facebook and Google, many of the time I have seen things being taken promptly. Now, I don't know if it's just my suggestion or it's a collective suggestion. Certainly, the same suggestion been given by a lot of people over a period of time. Mm-hmm. But I've seen that with the you know rapidness, they
show the response to the feedback. That
it's very spontaneous, mm-hmm. As compared to LinkedIn. So that's why you know I ask you this particular question that comparing to you know LinkedIn, Twitter.
I would say actually I have I am a LinkedIn user since long now, not just employee, but when I was employee, obviously I had a little closer look in terms of how they're handling these feedbacks and all that. But as a user, I have been using LinkedIn for quite some time, and I used to do the same thing, because at some point you used to feel so frustrated with some features, right? As a user, so I used to send out there that feedback link. I used to keep sending feedback, and I don't know, I never got response, but after some time I used to see that changed, like the feature which I have given feedback on, it has changed. So either they are collecting feedback from everyone and then doing it, you know, like once it's a similar mechanism, right? Like you collect feedback when you see the pattern. If it is that bubble is bigger, obviously that is going to be picked up first, right? So that's how the feedback is taken care of. And of course, the criticality of that feature, right? Of that feedback, how important it is to solve it immediately. Because I have seen that people actually tag Jeff Weiner. Now he's no more CEO, but people used to tag him. Okay. That this is not working. So LinkedIn should take care of this. And he used to actually tag his responsible person for taking care of that feedback.
On Twitter?
So I think, on LinkedIn. So on the feed, it used to happen. So yeah. I have seen this change in last few years in LinkedIn, definitely, the way responses and the way they are changing. And I think design-wise also, I definitely feel it's much better than what it was, at least as a user, I can say.
It has improved.
I agree with Ria. Ria interrupted Romini's side. So what happened was, similarly, I had some feedback sometime back, very recently indeed. And I know one person who is the current design manager at LinkedIn. So I just had a casual candid conversation with that person and we discussed design and the things that I was observing in the website and I suggested. And then he was really candid enough to tell me like, okay, we will take this feedback. This is really like, it might help us in the longer run. We will collect the feedback from you and let's see if we can do something productive about it. So it was very open, as in that transparency. I could see the transparency in understanding and discussing it through.
Yeah, no, definitely. And see, that's what also part of culture, right? Company
yes,
culture.
Yeah.
It has changed. I think this is again, I heard from employees also that it has changed a lot after Jeff has taken over earlier. So it is about changing the mindset of your own employees, being open for getting the criticism, but still
waiting. It's a lot about integration also. I'll tell you an incident. So I put a feedback on Twitter, and whosoever in the customer representative side, they see the feedback first. And then they replied back to me that, giving you this link, put the same feedback in our forum. तो मैंने उसको फटकार लगाया. मैंने बोला मेरा काम नहीं है फीडबैक देना. आई हैव गिवन यू, इट्स योर लक की यू हैव गॉट अ फीडबैक फ्रॉम मी एंड नाउ यू आर टेलिंग मी टू ओपन वन मोर पेज, यू नो, फिल इन सो मेनी ब्लैंक्स एंड देन पुट द फीडबैक. दैट मींस फर्स्ट लेवल इटसेल्फ यू आर, यू नो, हिंडरिंग द कस्टमर टू कनेक्ट विद यू. सो द मोर कॉम्प्लेक्स थिंग्स विल क्रिएट फॉर मी. आई वोंट फ्रॉम द नेक्स्ट टाइम इवन पुट द फीडबैक ऑल्सो. So then over a period of time in 6 months, I saw they have integrated their customer service desk more aligned to the user experience team, I think. Because since then,
One thing I would say, not in maybe context of LinkedIn, I am saying, but not necessary. Sometimes things are made little more complex because actually organization want it to be complex.
Just a tally.
There is an opportunity for them to sell more, right?
Yeah, they sell training sessions.
Exactly. So see, it is a strategy part. So maybe you are giving them feedback because you are looking at it from user's perspective. But
from a perspective.
Sometimes, yeah. And this is again not in context of LinkedIn, but that's how sometimes even strategy works, right?
Reminds me of a scenario for unsubscription from a Fitbit device. So I wanted to unsubscribe myself from Fitbit. And I couldn't find that space or page altogether.
Yeah,
so then what I did, I had to Google that where is this page in Fitbit mobile application. Then it told me you have to go to your Google subscription and subscribe from that area. And then subscribe.
That's the point. Like, it is made deliberately complex because they don't want you to easily use that feature.
I don't know. LinkedIn shouldn't be doing that for consumers. I mean.
Definitely. But definitely I have seen both the versions, at least for LinkedIn. I would talk about that. I have seen the old version and now I have seen the latest one. Of course, there are still small things which definitely can be improved. But at least I have seen that openness in terms of getting the feedback. And they may not do it immediately because you also know how the prioritization works, right, in the product. In terms of if there is any feature which is really critical to business, it is going to prioritize high. Certain things which is not maybe not bringing me a lot of revenue or not maybe a lot of clicks, I may not prioritize that, right?
I see it from a different perspective altogether because I work with GE Healthcare also. And then also, and other companies as well. If the alignment is good between the design team, the design VP, and the CEO and the chief technology officer and the CMO, chief marketing officer, then things really get very agile. It gets very spontaneous and change very fast. But if there is bureaucracy in that level. And then there are product managers who are from the technical side or from other sides and they don't have much idea about design, then things get very
easy. See, one thing has changed a big way and this I would say now all the companies which are doing well, right? The focus has changed to the users.
Yes.
So that is a big change has happened in last few years. And that's why you are seeing all this change. The way products are changing, it is more about what are the user needs, what are the functionalities they need. In LinkedIn, see the way, if you observe the way it is going on currently, the kind of features they are offering, the way they are trying to help people, because here many people got laid off in the US, outside the US. So the way they are trying to help, right? They are creating these events where they can help people refine their profiles or helping their basically utilize their own network to help others to find a job. See, lot of these things are part of all that big change, because they started focusing more on user, and it's no more just customer for them, more about user.
Yeah.
So Facebook, of course, Facebook also has a lot of design challenges, I would say. I always feel frustrated when I'm using groups.
Very big.
Messenger, yeah. And I always feel there are so many broken links within all, within those, their own products. So yeah, there are, I think it's a, we can maybe say that these are big ecosystems, right? Facebook, and so it's difficult. Now I know, like, the way when you design a refrigerator, one part handle is designing someone else, one internal shelf, one person is designing that shelf. So, so many people doing different areas of that product. When it comes together, there is going to be some gap.
So that's why the CEO, Center of Excellence, you know, plays a very important role in all the things.
Exactly. But see, that's also not all company has it.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I want to know. How about the Center of Excellence of LinkedIn and the Center of Excellence of SAP Lab?
So see, the way it works is, I would say, I would call it, it's more design system. It's all about design system. That's what I have noticed. It's not like there are, it's not like someone is going to like handhold you or guide you from that central team. Of course, they can guide you towards certain resources, or they can brief you on certain do's and don'ts and all that. But they are not going to sit with you and teach you or explain you each and everything how you should be doing for your use case, with your interpretation, how you use that information. So it works very differently. Though in consulting, I have seen that people used to have that Center of Excellence, right? Where people used to actually dedicated work across different LOBs within, say, it's TCS or Cognizant or any other consulting company. So in that format, it always worked, because they didn't have any design support as such, because these companies are never known for design company, unless you build that culture. In Cognizant, we did that. In Cognizant, we actually build that culture. So when I remember when I joined, that time it wasn't known for like design. But after a few years, it was known for that design group in Cognizant become really very strong. So that is something, is like, as a design group, what change you bring in the organization, it's up to you. But in product, definitely, I have seen that. And again, I think it's more, I keep analyzing that, like, why it happens. Because in consulting, I have seen that that concept of Center of Excellence used to work very smoothly.
Yes.
But with product, because I think it's more because of the product ecosystem, the scale of the company. Now imagine SAP, the kind of scale SAP has. So many products, in hundreds, there are so many products. So it's extremely difficult for any one person to hold that together. That's why they actually wanted it to be like isolate, or basically team dedicated to the product. And then build a design system. So at least there is some consistency. Otherwise, everything will be actually done differently for all product in SAP.
It will never align properly.
That's a pretty much like different companies, never ending that the different culture for different organization. So in all people, we have a different kind of experience. So yeah, as I see your website, it's lots of things to you can share with us. That right now you're talking about as a designer part from your end, like some case studies. And can you little bit again elaborate that I saw some life around design and as a leader. That part, yeah, can you please elaborate that part, please? I mean,
definitely. Are... Let me share some of the stuff doing it.
Thanks.
I have done in past and I'm actually doing right now also. So, see, again, as over the period, now many of you have multiple years of experience. Now, I think as maybe you spend, say, 7-8 years in design, you start realizing, okay, very strongly, what are you passionate about? Of course, in my case, luckily, design is my passion. But you also get more specific in the certain areas, like, okay, what do you enjoy more? And it changes over the period, right? as you develop your experience. I particularly am very, very passionate about kids and education. I really enjoy teaching kids. And this is something I used to do in India also, especially the young students. I used to actually go to MIT Design Institute in Pune, where I used to go as a guest lecturer for UX people, students from the UX discipline. And then I used to go also for jury. And I really enjoyed that, like teaching and basically collaborating with students. So that is something I continued after moving to US also. So I would say there are a few things which I keep doing it as I get time. So there are two things which I usually do. One is design thinking session, and then second is basically creative thinking session. So creative thinking is basically all about art. It's more about how do you implement your ideas, right? How do you be more creative? How do you explore different mediums, right? Because exploration is something... it actually makes you a little bit more bolder. That's what I always feel like. And especially with the tangible material, right? Like when you use colors, when you like paint something, that's where you gain that confidence to explore something, right? Because you're not like fearful about maybe getting something wrong or you're messing it up. And especially with kids, I somehow feel the kind of energy they bring in and the amazing out-of-the-box thinking they have, right? Naturally, that is something really fascinates me. So I volunteer with this organization, Code for Fun, very regularly. Usually there are summer camps. I conduct some product design workshop or design thinking workshop for students which are middle school or high school students. And this picture in the middle is basically the art workshop, art exploration workshop. So I basically took kids through the ideation process, and then the outcome, what they eventually came up with, is this. All these other pictures are product design workshops which I did. So here you see this, the girl who did this, the left bottom sketch. So it was about how do you build empathy, right? Or how do you design something to solve the problem you're facing right now? So she came up with some idea which she was facing problem for. So it's very funny also, like sometimes the kind of ideas kids come up with, right? They don't really think about the feasibility part, and they are like freely thinking about all these things. So that is something I personally really enjoy. Currently, I'm also doing a fundraiser right now for the school district where my daughter goes. The main reason, again, I felt after all this change happened, the virtual schooling, it was a very sudden change. And unfortunately, now kids, at least in US, kids really can't go back to school till next fall. So basically, the entire remaining school year, now they are going to be at home and going to study online, which is definitely very unfortunate, because they are going to miss on the experience of meeting friends, basically discussing a lot of things, the experience of having lunch together, all of that. And that's where I felt maybe I should maybe use my skills to help maybe organization here, so that they can prepare a little better in terms of the infrastructure. So little bit from my side. So I'm volunteering right now, doing a fundraiser for all the high school students for design thinking workshop. So I'm doing every Saturday, I'm doing a workshop with them online. And every week we have some challenge. So last week, actually we did some exercise, which was basically the focus was more on empathy building. That I love to paint. I paint a lot. I actually in July 2019 I did my art show along with few of my college my batchmates in Pune.
So you have the take for that what the mask they design or it's like
no. Let me share that. I actually had a PPT prepared.
Okay.
Let me share that with you. It's really amazing because I don't know, the kids give me so much energy.
The most energetic and most interesting people can get.
They are very exactly. Motivated because the perspective that they think from, it's totally different at times.
And there are a lot of things. Yeah, there are a lot of things. Those are very simple. And sometimes we don't even think about it. So I wonder sometimes how come they thought about it and I didn't think about it.
One thing I realize from my end, because they don't have some certain guideline or you have to follow this kind of font or this kind of, because if exactly. We think we have a certain guideline, you have to follow this guideline, you have to follow this font size, you have to follow this color, it's a yes. Company guideline, but they are free. They are free from all these things, right? So they think freely. That's the thing.
Okay, so can you see the screen?
Yeah.
So this is something, again, it's a work in progress. I have not put together it for you, but this was the first theme. This is the first workshop that I did last weekend. And this was the problem statement. Like, how might we help grandparents protect them from COVID-19? The scenario was given to them that now everything is locked down. There is a curfew in India or even here. And they can't really, your grandparents can't really go out. So, and even masks are out of storage now. They are not getting any masks. So how can you help them prepare and protect themselves? So this is the, so now I prepared this later on Mural, because Mural is a little complex for students to use, but they did with the actual post-its at their end, because obviously this was a virtual collaboration. So they wrote down all these points at their end, and then they shared later on with me their pictures of that. So I just put it together. So it was all about like card sorting, right? What they think, what they like, right? What they need, how they feel. So you see, this is all coming from all these kids. And the big ideas came out of this is like creating something which is out of material available in their house. Creating something which is more reusable mask. Creating something more personalized mask. So they came up with these big ideas, very nice ideas. So these are some of the sketches. Of course, these are kids, so obviously don't expect that it will be something very nice and neat and clean, but you can see some of the ideas here. So one idea was that kid actually wanted to brand the mask because his grandfather likes certain brand, the cap, and he wanted to have a mask with a cap covered fully covered his head, and then below the mask will have a zipper so that whenever he needs to eat, his grandpa needs to eat, he can just open the zipper and eat it.
Wow,
this is really interesting.
It's amazing,
very
right?
Interesting.
Yeah,
here you see the dark, that two dots and that H. Yeah. So they thought about like, it's very itchy sometime, right? Because see, now the scenario was given, they can't remove the mask. They have to all the time wear the mask. And I heard that in India, actually, they are giving this guidance. So you have to keep wearing mask if you're going out. Or so that was the scenario. So in that case, they thought about, okay, this might hurt behind the ear. So what can I do? So they put the cotton balls here and then the little thicker cotton so that it won't hurt their grandpa's ear, right? So see, these are the things which we are trying to help build in the kid.
Yeah, this kid will definitely grow up to be a product designer.
Another thing here, this guy, he actually, see, don't think about again whether feasible and whether this idea is good or bad, but I would never think about this. So he thought about creating a pocket to the mask where he can store the tissue paper or store the hand sanitizer. Wow. In the mask. And he said, I would create it maybe by my grandfather's used shirt, maybe the old shirt, which he's not going to use. So I will use that cotton shirt and I'll make masks. Because shirt has a pocket, right? So he can use that pocket.
Oh, okay. That area he can cut down.
Yeah.
Really?
It's amazing, right? Like the way they come up with these ideas. Then this was another idea where this girl actually used the shoelace. And her idea was using things which are available in the house. So she said, in India, usually we use the banyan, right? So she said, I will use my grandpa's banyan because he always like wearing banyan when he is in the house. So he has a lot of that. So I will use that banyan, and then my granny wears Punjabi dress. So she, I will use her old Punjabi dress to make it more look nice and fancy. And these are the shoelaces, how she will tie it. So that was another idea. So what I did is actually my mom speech clothes and also this is something my mom is also very passionate about, like doing things with me. So she this one, right, this mask what you see here, this is the version. So the way she did a quick prototype of that, so you hang the mask and then behind this you see this gap where you can put the tissue for a little bit more safety. And this is the front. You put the mask and then the bottom, these two rings, basically you tie behind the head. So this is the prototype.
Yeah. this is really nice.
This is nice. I mean, you have the sketch, you have that prototype and everything.
Exactly. This is like an end-to-end design thinking.
Correct.
That we
use. This is how I was actually conducting it. This week, actually, I have more kids because some of them, they were not sure. First of all, parents don't understand, right? What is design thinking?
Yeah.
But then I think kids, when we started, some of them said, I joined because my parents asked me to. But when I ended it, they were like so engaged and they didn't want to close the call. So I think this time I have more kids joining this workshop. So yeah. So this is what I keep doing. I'm not actually doing office work. And apart from that, what other things?
Meanwhile, Ria, Feras had a question for you. Feras, would you like to go ahead now? Ask a question to Ria.
Sure, Ria. Hi. This is Feras here, Ria. I'm based out of Hyderabad. I work as a UX manager at a company called CBRE. Hope you are aware of that. It's a real estate giant. So I work as a UX manager out here. So my question here is that in a lot of talks and sessions that we have, right, we usually talk a lot about what is research, how do you conduct research, and what are the different steps you follow and things like those. But what we mostly forget to talk about more is of usability testing, right? Which is one of the most important attribute in the whole process, right? So can you throw some light out of your experience and on how to conduct, and some experience that you have out of the sessions that you conducted for usability testing, and some best practices around it, so that we can learn from there.
Yeah, definitely. And that's actually one of my favorite topic also, because I really enjoy doing user testing. I love the way user reacts, right? And it also, sometimes it's also funny the way they reacts when something is failing. Like, you design something so passionately and they within a second they said, what crap, this is I don't get it. So that's why I really enjoy research part particularly. And the way especially with SAP, I'm doing it very extensively. So the way I do it, basically, I have a junior designers with me. My role is more like planning and then conducting the user testing. But I have my junior designer with whom I work to do the scripting part. We write the script. We decide, first of all, what are the flows that we want to really target. What are the, for example, in my case right now, I recently did user testing for Service Cloud product that I'm working on. And we had B2B and B2C both audience. So we wanted to test the product for both the scenarios. And then, so we created end-to-end flow for both the scenarios. But of course, like if you have a very static flow, I use InVision particularly for testing the flows or testing the designs. So InVision obviously doesn't give you a lot of flexibility or that feel, right? Something if you deal with the live system. So you don't get that feel. So that's why instead of testing the end-to-end flow, what I do, I usually break it into small tasks. And we design the script, basically questionnaire, according to what exactly we need input on. So for example, currently what I'm working on is the new concept, the new product we are trying to build. So it is all about, first of all, testing whether the product, overall product works, right, in terms of the the way product is designed in terms of the content, in terms of the functionality, features, all of it. And again, from the product perspective, now we have a data from customers, right? What functionality customers, like they should must have those kind of features. So we have a priority from the product management. And then accordingly, we prioritize those tasks in the user testing. And we test those tasks first. And there are a few areas where we can take a little bit more time to explore and we need maybe more inputs. Those we still test it, but then we can leverage maybe more time and again go back and retest those things. But some of the things what we tested recently is something which right now going in the product.
I like the thing that you said, break it into small flows and things so that it also aligns to our principle, which says like fail early, right? So once you fail early and you don't have the whole prototype ready and then you feel, oh my God, what have I designed? So rather than that, fail in all the steps that you have been doing or the flow you have been doing and then improve it right from the beginning itself, right? So. Thanks for that. Any particular tools you use, Ria, which is like unmoderated testing where we do remote testing and things like those?
We do remote testing and we have a user Zoom, user testing account actually. And that is something we just got recently, but earlier I actually use Zoom
okay.
Video calls.
So you just.
So it was not video call. This time we did only audio. We used to share the screens.
Okay.
Either you share the screen with them, give the control to the user. Because see, in our case, it was a new product. So we didn't want to give away the links to anyone. Of course, there is a procedure where user actually, the candidate needs to sign the NDA and everything.
Right.
But still, we didn't want to take a chance. So what we did this time is we gave the control to the user, candidate, and then they basically walk through the process or the tasks. That one way of doing the initial last year, what I did, that time we had given the links to user in advance. So like before, just before the call. And they used to open the link and then they used to browse through it. And we used to record the session. So it was all audio and screen sharing. And it's a virtual collaboration. So the candidate recruitment is something we did through Respondent.io. But that is something again now you can, you have different options now. It's not like that time we didn't have option. We had a Respondent.io account. So we tried leveraging that. But that in that actually you have to create a screener where you have to define what persona, what is the target audience, and you have to give the specific who will be basically applicable for applying for this testing. And then you have to screen it. So it's a little bit of work, but we did that. But that was, I felt that was a good learning experience for us also, how actually that screening happens, right? Because when you know, right, what exactly audience you're looking for, you can screen better. That's what I felt. But with all the new other tools, I think you can also manage user Zoom, right? Or user testing.
I think it's user testing.
With user testing, I think you don't have to do all that. They will screen it for you and they will manage all that part. Yeah. And then again, once now, as I said, like the testing, the first level of testing is done. We have a feedback. The way now we are going back and we prioritize what was the feedback, what was the critical one. whether it is aligned with our product prioritization, the feature prioritization. And then some of those high priority we have taken up, we updated the experience based on the feedback, and now it's going in the product. So next testing will be when we have a beta version.
Okay, cool. Yeah, just to, I was confused with the user Zoom and user testing, because the reason is we are using Zoom so much that I thought it must be.
And I'm sorry, it's user testing.
It is user Zoom. No, it is user Zoom.
It is user Zoom because we recently, last week only, we got that email. I haven't even looked at it.
Yeah.
Because for our this recent testing, I have used all Zoom and Zoom calls basically.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think user Zoom is better because they will also give you the analysis of everything. I think whatever the findings, they give you all that analysis. So that's a good one.
Great. Thank you.
Great, yeah, thanks a lot. So any other questions from anyone else? Okay, I think we do not have any other questions right now from the forum.
No, that's good. It was very interesting actually talking to everyone.
I have one question.
No, right? How things are happening. Sorry, someone said something.
Yeah. Hi, Ria. I have one question from you.
Sure.
Seeing at the present situation and the way the industry is transforming, what do you suggest for the UX designers, how they can update themselves and for the next 5 or 10 years?
See, I think... the way I'm looking at it is there is always an opportunity if something bad is happening, right? None of us were prepared for this phase, right? Everything very suddenly, within a day, we all, like at least we moved to work from home mode. The earlier day, we got a mail that from tomorrow, you are not coming to office, you will be working from home. So mentally, I think we were not prepared. But I think after 1 week, I realized that you have so much time now. Of course, we end up working extra hours now because you are more focused. Lot of things, commute and all that has cut down. You are home, so you are not worried about maybe reaching home on time and about your family. So you are more focused on work. You have more time. So I feel this is the best time to invest within yourself as well as things which you could not do maybe earlier because of all these things, right? Like you have to travel and especially Bangalore and all these areas, right? Mumbai. It's so much travel, even Chennai. It's so much travel that people spend just hours and hours just commuting to the work. So I personally feel it's a good opportunity for us to update. There are a lot of free trainings going on right now. LinkedIn Learning, a lot of courses are there. So I feel we should do all that. We should maybe, whatever is possible, we should go through that learning and upgrade ourselves.
Ria, since you brought that point, do you suggest that learning sites, right? Do you suggest any blogs or which, as I said, I'm new to UX also. So as a learning path, do you suggest any blogs or any learning sites which I can go through this time?
I would say one thing maybe all of us, I'm doing it, maybe you guys should also do is look for trends. What's happening right now in the design or overall in industry, right? Not just design, but what's the trend? Are you aligned? Your skills are aligned with that trend, right? If not, how can you upgrade them? And right now is the best time because see, a lot of courses or these things are pretty, they're expensive. But if you want to invest, they actually currently many organizations are reducing the cost because of all this sudden change, right? So they are more empathetic and giving you that less charges. In some cases, LinkedIn Learning, actually a lot of things are free. So I personally do a lot of courses on LinkedIn just to maybe upgrade or know more about topics. So particularly in AI, right? So this is something I would say you should know a lot of things about AI. When I did, I worked for machine learning AI, say 2.5 years back. I had no clue about it. So for me, it took little, and again, on top of it, it's a very technical topic, right? It's a very technical subject. But then as a designer, what is it that you can do, or how you can contribute, or how you can lead design for ML, right? That is something was a challenge for me. Mm-hmm. And it was very satisfying the way I've gone through that process. Of course, in that case, it was more of a, of course, I read through a lot of things. I used Medium as a, one of the things. There were a lot of articles there. I wrote one article because writing also clear up your concepts many times.
Correct. Yeah.
So I did that. I read a lot of material on AI. You search and you get a lot of material in terms of what is actually concept is. How does it work? How does machine learning work? We don't need to know the very, very technical aspects. At least if you don't have a technical background, what you need to know is the concept. That's what I did for myself. I learned the concept of what is AI, what is machine learning, and then how can I design for it? So look for these trends and upgrade yourself so that when things are normal again, back to what it was, you are already prepared for that.
Absolutely. Sir, thank you.
That's
so
what
much.
I'm doing. And also maybe do things which you won't be able to do otherwise because of, as I said, like commute and other responsibilities, right? When you go to work, it's a different schedule altogether.
Correct.
So right? That's a very good point that Riya made. Like, this is a time we can utilize for self-development related to work and the immediate task that we do, and also our hobbies at the same time. That would help us in rejuvenating.
And another thing now, we also figured out, right? Like, what is working? See, like, nothing is stopping you guys also. You started this online forum. Everyone is coming together. I'm actually surprised to see so many people on Saturday morning attending a session, which is pretty impressive. Like, that's where you see that even designers are so interested in learning, right? They are keen doing additional or investing additional time into their learnings.
Absolutely. And you know, Riya, like, I got an, as in, I, the purpose of Riya putting a registration for this kind of talk was just to understand how many people are registering. So I got 60 email that 60 people from various location has registered, but somehow we have 25, which is still a good number, but maybe from my end now I will try to find out, like, what could make the 60, the 40 more people come onto the platform?
You should always send a feedback. Maybe have a survey.
Yes, that I will do, yes. So even for me also, it is very new. Like, I started this platform like few months back only. So along with the others, along with Vishwajit and Kailash. So every day even I am learning my own things daily. Yeah.
Now you, three of you are doing really good job. I think it's needed right now. And even if things are going back to normal, I think now people are understanding the power of virtualization, right?
Absolutely.
And it's a good part. So certain things you don't need to be physically there. It can happen through the virtual collaboration. So why not, right?
Okay. Hi, Riya. And I think I have a question for anyone on this Zoom, or even specifically for Riya, right? See, I see a lot of young designers, like one of them just asked a question on how they can learn and things like those. One more difficulty what we find here in India is, especially for the young designers who want to join into the roles of user experience and all that, they are asked for some specific degrees, right? A lot of preferences given to the design degrees that we have nowadays, like the MIT Design Institute that you mentioned, NID and NIFT and things like those. So if the people are having some design background in terms of the academics, they are given more preference, and a lot of youngsters are left out from getting into any kind of UX related job. So I see that a lot here. I'm a manager. I hire myself, and I see a lot of people, who struggle to get into, the UX roles. So I would like to know from you or anyone out there, are there any kind of, the courses which can make them academically strong? I understand LinkedIn and there are other things that can help you gain a lot of knowledge, that's for sure. But anything else that can add on to your profile and, so that it becomes easy for you to, jump into a UX role. So it's for open for anyone. Maybe Ria, unless for Ria, because you have moved to US and you would be a little, cut out of, the kind of trend we are following here. But yeah, it happens a lot here.
Yeah, Faraz, maybe I can answer a bit of this. So I think what is required is definitely in the job experience. So in fact, even when I started, I don't have a degree in UX. I don't have a degree in UI. Okay, I started as a web designer. I learned the ropes. I studied. And then because I feel there is a lot of online resources everywhere. So, and then in fact, when I start hiring people, I've hired people in my this organization, my previous organization. So what generally I ask for is not degrees or diplomas. It's more like what you have done. So, and that is important if you have an in the job experience, because especially what happened is here, proper UX UI degree is very expensive. So, but then other than that, you can actually learn a lot, through self, a 600 rupees book will actually teach you more than maybe a lakh rupees course.
I agree, because it goes
end to end.
Right.
So yeah,
Robert, I agree with you that even in hiring, I do the similar kind of approach where we need to look more into the kind of knowledge they have and all. But yeah, I'm just trying to ask this question so that it benefits the new designers. What happens is I see a lot of people who want to get into UX, because they do not have a degree and all. A lot of companies actually refrain from hiring them, and their resume is not even shortlisted, right? I have seen that a lot because I have a lot of UX managers who are my friends as well, who have been given this kind of direction and all that. So this is just a question so that if there are any degrees which are short-term degrees and things like those, which can actually add on to the profile and make things a little easier for people to join in. Also, one more example I would give you is what used to happen is, maybe 10 years, 11 years back from now, there are a lot of, openings in the web designing part and graphic designing part, but no one actually knew what is UX, right? I remember when I used to give interviews, people used to not understand what is UX. They used to ask me all visual designing questions and, they used to ask me, do you know Photoshop and you are hired, right? That kind of stuff. So that is not happening currently, right? That is not happening currently, especially in India, right? So I want to help those designers out there who are not having any design background, but and because they have learned a bit of UX and they want to get into this field, right? See what is the way to help them out and see if there are any micro degrees or things like those which can help them fetch this job. So that is my concern.
I don't know. I thought it might have changed a little bit in India because I could definitely relate to this. As you said, when I used to hire in India, obviously used to look for these degrees because of very obvious reason. But I thought maybe last 7-8 years things have changed, at least here in US. Of course, they look for degrees, but they are not married to it. You have to have it. It is always required, or it is all not required, but it is always preferred if you have design degree. But if you are ready to join, start at a very junior level, even person with an engineering background or some other background, with maybe some courses, like as you said, short courses, right? For example, there are some certification, online certification. Nelson Group has some certifications. I don't know about human factors, if they have any short courses, because there's, I think,
They have actually launched an online course as well, Ria. So the factors
because
also.
See, in such cases where you have no background, right, or no degree, formal college degree in design, then I would say at least do certain courses which has industry weightage. So go with those courses. And then in that investment would be little, I would say, more justified, and more likely you will get a chance or job when you go out with that degree. For example, now human factors, I know for sure, that's why I'm talking about them. But yes, human factors, CUA degree is well known. It is established. It has a credibility. So that's one. Nelson's, I think one is, I know they have online courses. There are a few things which IDEO has, I think. But IDEO is more on a creative aspect. I think even they have some UX courses. But I guess now with this virtual situation, right, there will be more opening for such kind of courses for UX particularly. But the criteria, I would say, go with something or suggest to go with certification which has some credibility in the market, which has some weightage, because that is what will take you, at least will get you the interview.
Any feedback about the IDF courses themselves?
Which one?
The IDF, the Interaction Design Foundation courses, they have quite a lot of online courses.
Yeah, so see, all these things, right, like it should be known. That's why my point. And as long as it is known, everyone knows, and it has that weightage, then it's easy sell for that candidate also, right? Okay, I have done this. I know the basics. I know the how to apply those concepts. Because when every hiring manager is looking for that, right? And imagine, see, at a manager level, you are also looking for different level of people. So when you hire junior, it is given that they would need some little bit of handholding, and they will need, there will be learning curve, versus like someone comes with that foundation, solid foundation, that learning curve is little flattened, right? So that's how even manager look at it. So how much manager needs to invest in that candidate versus how whether that candidate is ready to actually hit the ground. All these factors are there. So if you have good learning from some good institute, then it's likely to click very quickly.
Sure. Thank you, Ria.
Hello.
Yeah, even Coursera is there. Maybe try Coursera also. Coursera is also good.
Coursera and even IDF also has some good articles and proper step-by-step guidance towards being a UX designer from beginners to being experts. Yeah, those courses.
Yeah, and another thing maybe what you can do is maybe get some freelance stuff, right? Like if you get, see, what you need is you need to show some experience. That's another thing companies look for, right? They want to see that you have proven experience. So if you can do maybe to establish yourself some freelance stuff, right? Some UX freelance work, that would also help.
Yeah, maybe I would even add to it that maybe, in fact, if you don't actually get freelance stuff also, you can come up with your own maybe problem and solutions, and then just study whatever, and then just come up with a own solution, and then show those works as well.
I think from IDEA point of view, maybe this could be one thing that we can take up as a group and form a group of designers and come up with a hypothetical problem or some kind of a project and do it in terms of this. So that could be another.
Actually, in the current situation, you have good opportunity to maybe come up with such problem statements and see how you can, maybe it can be, it can have, maybe it might have a social aspect to it.
Absolutely, yeah.
But something maybe as a design community, if you can address. So just to give you example here, here we are, there is one design community where they're addressing, they are using actually design thinking to solve the problem for homeless. So they are working on the solution for homeless people are facing here. So they, long time ago, they have sent a message on LinkedIn, whoever is interested, and they can actually contribute, join that group and contribute to that group. So it is more like a design thinking sessions they conduct. They define what is the problem they are trying to solve and then come up with a solution for that. And then they further they work with the government or whatever based on the outcome. They work with those organizations to implement that.
Yeah, absolutely. Like this is a wonderful opportunity also for all of us. This reminds me today morning only I saw news where they said Apple and Google for the first time they collaborated and they have started working on an application and they will be launching it soon so that we can detect who the people are around in our contact list. If we have people who might have got a fever or something related to COVID, so we will be notified and we will be put in a self-quarantine mode accordingly. So this is the first time they came together for this kind of a cause in a way.
So see, this is how maybe as a community, maybe you guys can help in India. So you know, the you are on ground there, you know the problems, what are the problems everyone facing. So identify the needs, and if you can help either government or you can help maybe individuals or you can help the society with around you, just define those problems and then maybe have different projects assigned to each need.
Absolutely, yeah,
that's
a very good point.
Yeah, I would like to share what we are doing right now at the since there is a problem, there are various volunteers which are working to facilitate the normalcy, taking foods for the needy ones here. And there is a problem of the voluntary management here with the government. There are NGOs which are working, and the government is monitoring, and there is a coordination required. We have actually worked here by developing an app to manage that. And recently, means tomorrow, yesterday only, we have developed an app regarding that whole the management of all the this volunteerism thing, and it is quite automating the process. And it is came out of as an community level only.
You see, that's why I really like, first of all, this idea. You three of you started this group, right? I think what you should definitely, as a community, how we can make this community strong, maybe that you should work towards. And this was one very good point, actually. How can we help people who want to establish themselves as a designer? Because we all know, right? People who work multiple years in design, how difficult it is for anyone new to come in and start maybe performing, right? First of all, getting the job as a designer if it's a non-designer and with no design education background, right? So maybe that can be your another goal, like how can we help such group, right? Group of designers.
Definitely, yes, yes. And these are very constructive goals in that way. Like it is, it's something we
so
can...
Maybe in such projects, you can leverage these kind of people, right? Who has a maybe don't have a design background, but they are willing to learn and they're ready to help on some of these kind of projects, right? So for them, it's like, see, it should be mutual. It's not like only one person getting benefited out of something, right? So if you are getting maybe help from others to design something which is like meaningful for someone else, maybe for society or whatever you are building, but at the same time, those people are also building their portfolio by doing some UX work.
Definitely, yes, absolutely. Yeah.
It's win for both, right?
Yeah.
Correct. Yes.
Absolutely, Ria. That's really a good thought that you shared with us. Perfect. And let's take it up in the next sessions, guys, as in whenever we will have our next one-on-one and the local sessions, group sessions, then we will take it up again. So I think for today, do we have any other questions from anyone? We have already crossed the timeline, and for Ria, it's quite late at night, I know.
So I actually didn't realize. I was like enjoying so much chatting with all of you. I didn't realize that.
Totally, Ria. It was really great to have you on this platform, and everything that you shared with me was really appreciated. It's really nice. Thank you for being on the platform and sharing your
time. And feel free to, if you need any help from me, definitely. If I can, like,
yes,
definitely, anytime, feel free to reach out.
Definitely. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Everyone, stay safe.
Take care.
Stay safe.
Thank you all.
Stay safe. Take care and have a nice weekend.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.